Cape Fear, the French Broad, and the Catawba. And that's when the state intervened and blocked enforcement.
Gotcha.
And in South Carolina, the agency didn't...
137
acres. Jeez.
So these are, this one on the Dan is actually one of the smallest coal ash ponds. And these sit on every major river in North Carolina, French Broad, Cape Fear. After the coal ash spill in 2009 from the Tennessee Valley, basically saying they were confident that their coal ash ponds were fine and everything like that. So this is the pipe discharge. You've seen all the media and the headlines, 70 miles, some of the turtles. Okay, so we're out there on the 4th. They want to have your camera guy let us get in and ferry over because he'll have good, stable, be able to get some good B-roll.
Nice.
But when we're dragging all the boats down, we'll let you guys go down here first so you can get some video, at least of the power plant from the water that's more stable than the boat, probably. Awesome. And that'd be...
That's really it. These are.
So, this one is way that this is not the real trying to get him to tell a story. I've been asking him, so look, you know, because, you know, these are 65-year-old, 70-year-old people that are, just, you know, both his brothers work for him. And, you know, they're just kind of conservative, and they never, you know, just pay all that. So I'm just, you know, I just talked to him today on the left arm and click one. I know I'm trying to make it very simple. Story. But if you can save one life, if you can at least get somebody some treatment, you know, is it worth it? You know, I just want you to think about
it. So let's head up. So are you going to come with us?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
I am, yeah.
All right, great.
If that's okay. All
right, so I'm just going to have you three and Carrie. Yeah.
Doesn't matter.
All right.
I was going to put Carrie with me and them in the other canoe.
Well.
Hold on. Okay. Oh, it's stuck.
John, will you give me a shove?
Yeah.
You
want to come up?
Pegs okay? Can you feel those?
Yeah, there they are.
No, you want your feet forward.
Yes, good.
Yeah.
Very good.
Let's get out in the middle of the river.
All right.
Get away from those limbs over there.
You ready?
Yeah, you go for it, Matt. Can we drift just for one second?
Yeah.
Me drift or keep going?
You're fine.
Bunch of
Yeah, put that on good.
Great stuff, Dave.
You want me to splash here?
Sure.
I was going to get one of you to send it.
That's all right.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
When we dock out, you should roll. I don't think you're going to roll.
Can we drift for one sec?
That's what I use. Yeah. A couple of years ago. See, they built them right along.
They got a shot of us dragging the portage guy across.
This is it. This is the Dan River Steam Station. You can see they built these right along the side of the water so they can use that water to generate electricity. And right on the other side of this dam is the coal ash ponds. Are the coal ash ponds.
Yeah, let me stay up here a little longer. Okay.
All right, so this is it. This is the Dan River Steam Facility. It's been retired for a couple of years, but you can see they built these right along the river so they can use that water to generate electricity. And right on the other side of the dam are those coal ash ponds.
Three, two, one.
So this is it, the Dan River Steam Station. It's been retired for a couple of years, but you can see they built it right along the water so they can use that river to help generate electricity. And right on the other side of this dam are those coal ash ponds.
One more like that.
Okay. Three, two, one. So this is it, the Dan River Steam Station. It's been retired for a couple of years, but you can see they built it right along the river so they can use the water to help generate that.
Got a shot. Get this way. That's
right. Right there?
Yep.
Three, two, one. So this is it, the Dan River Steam Station. It's been retired for a couple of years, but you can see they built it right along the river so they can use the water to help generate the electricity. But right on the other side of the dam are those coal ash ponds. Right, so if you could say and spell your first and last name, so I have
sure. My name's Dean Nayaks, D-E-A-N, last name N-A-U-J-O-K-S, and I work for Yakin River Keeper Incorporated.
Perfect. All right. So tell me a little bit where we are, just first. Back. Okay. Tell me like where we're standing. What are we looking at?
Well, behind us is the Dan River plant, Duke's retired coal-fired power plant. Right below it is the two coal ash ponds, one of which broke and leaked into the Dan River. Causing a major coal ash spill.
Gotcha. So tell me about where you were when you heard that, or when you found out about it. Where were you doing, and what was your just initial reaction when you heard what was going on?
Well, when we heard that there was a coal ash spill up on the Dan River, we weren't surprised from the Kingston spill back in 2008. Yakin River Keeper, as well as river keepers all over the state, have been filing cases against Duke and the state of North Carolina to address contamination from coal ash. So we knew at 37 coal ash ponds located on rivers all around the state that eventually something like this would likely happen.
So was it kind of like a here we go, you know, this is what we saw coming moment?
Yeah, I mean, you know, first year kind of not sure how to respond, you know, but then you immediately figure out what went wrong with the Kingston spill. And that was the good thing is Waterkeeper Alliance and the River Keepers, we were ready after the Kingston spill to get a rapid response team out, get out, start doing water quality monitoring right away. We were able to get our data out before DENR or EPA were able to get their data out. And I think it was really important for just keeping DENR accountable for what they were reporting. And obviously they did not report information accurately and they had to retract that. So I thought it was really important that we're out here right away on the ground. And then working with local people like Dan River Basin Association, I thought was we had a good team out here constantly throughout this last month or so.
Excellent. So when you get out to the site and you see, describe what you saw first of all.
Well, you know, when we first got out here, obviously the big 48-inch pipe was hemorrhaging a lot of the coal ash for obviously a week. So that was obviously a big part of our early response was sampling that. But what's coming out in the media now is a lot of what we were finding right from the beginning was these illegal discharges from these pipes that were conveying the same type of material that you find in coal ash through discharges into the Dan River, Then we also sampled the second pipe that was discovered, which is, you know, at risk of rupturing, was leaking. And then also seeps. You know, there's a stream that runs around the side of the coal ash pond. We knew from the color of the water, the orange rocks and the smell, that there was probably coal ash that was seeping into that. And again, the state of North Carolina has already identified that these coal ash ponds are seeps, have seeps, are leaching, are leaking from their toe drains, contaminants into groundwater as well as surface water. So we were looking at the big coal ash spill, not just the pipe itself, but really trying to look at what is the overall impact of these coal ash ponds. We already know, but we thought it was really important for the public to understand that these things are leaking from all over the place, not only from discharges that Duke constructed illegally, but then also these seeps and toe drains, which are contaminating groundwater and surface water.
And tell me some of the things you found in these discharges after doing some water testing.
Well, so we tested some of the discharges actually upstream from the pipe that ruptured. The third pipe that's now been discovered, we found arsenic levels that were pretty high, well above maximum contaminant level. We found, you know, obviously arsenic, lead, chromium, manganese, iron, boron. So a lot of the contaminants that you find in coal ash are found in the discharges that are coming off of these coal ash ponds as well into surface waters and also contaminating groundwater.
So what kind of impacts, I mean, are we talking, you're on the river every day, or just about every day, this is what you study, this is what you do. What kind of, I mean, for someone who knows it so well, what kind of impacts are we talking about coal ash having on the river, just the river itself?
Well, I think, you know, Duke has done a really good job of downplaying the impact these coal ash ponds are having, but we know firsthand that their coal ash ponds have contaminated private wells down in the Wilmington area from the Sutton plant. We know that they've contaminated wells up on the French Broad area. I know the High Rock Lake, the Buck Steam plant, which has three coal ash ponds, which actually dwarf these ponds, are contaminating people's wells, or people are now have heavy metals in their blood. So there is a real big public health issue, not just to drinking water, not just from the long-term contamination of fish from the spill, but these ponds, as long as they're here, these are unlined, as long as they're here, they're going to continue to leach contaminants into the groundwater, into people's drinking water supplies, into people's private wells, affecting property values and drinking water supplies downstream. So we've known this for a long time, and unfortunately Duke has had a lot of favoritism from North Carolina Department of Environment and Natural Resources, shielding them from enforcement. And it's just really, it's about time. We were grateful that the judge ordered that Duke clean up all 37 of its coal ash ponds and start addressing contaminations to groundwater and surface water.
Is it frustrating doing the work and seeing these results yourself and just knowing that the state agency who's supposed to be regulating this maybe isn't doing the best job, you know, that they're supposed to?
Yeah, I mean, it is frustrating. I mean, we deal with this on a lot of different issues, you know, and I could go on and on, but, you know, it is frustrating when the environmental agency, whose mission is to protect public health and the environment, continues to downplay threats to public health and the environment. And we see that with the coal ash ponds. And quite honestly, if this coal ash spill did not happen, I think, you know, privately, behind the scenes and in the courts, river keepers would have continued to fight this for years to come. In many ways, this has been a blessing because it has brought attention to not only this problem, but 37 coal ash ponds, which are sitting on the banks of rivers all over the state and could happen at any time. The one on Mountain Island Lake in Charlotte, if that were to fail there, would go into a drinking water supply for 850,000 people. And it's just, it's time for this agency to work with the Environmental Protection Agency and Duke to clean up all 37 of its coal ash ponds. And, you know, we're just grateful that's actually finally starting to move forward.
Perfect. And what do you want to see happen with these ponds?
Well, you know, we've had river keepers in South Carolina, which have already got SCG&E and Santee Cooper to agree to clean up 11 million tons of coal ash in South Carolina. So the state of South Carolina is gonna be eliminated from the threats and dangers of coal ash ponds. And we feel the people of North Carolina deserve the same. So we wanna see Duke clean up all 37 of these coal ash ponds. Remove the coal ash, clean up the ponds and the groundwater contamination they've created, move it to dry storage, obviously line landfills, just like we're required to do for our banana peels and household municipal waste. Duke should be required to do that for toxic coal ash, which has been sitting on the banks of our rivers for over 50 years. And then obviously address the public health issues. People who they need to require medical monitoring, provide that free service to people who feel like their drinking water supplies have been contaminated. and then deal with providing clean water to people who've lost clean, you know, water from contamination from these coal ash ponds, particularly in private wells, and eliminate threats from upstream from private drinking water, public drinking water supplies, because at least Mountain Island Lake down in Charlotte, as well as in the Cape Fear, these are directly upstream from major drinking water supplies for a lot of people here in the state of North Carolina.
Let me, I gotta have to do that one again because.
Okay. Got.
Do we need to move? No. I can adjust it. I have my shutter and I can't adjust it on the fly. Okay. Yeah, because it's getting darker over here and it's a lot brighter over there now.
Should I stay out light more?
Yeah, I guess.
Like
yeah.
This?
We were good. Yeah,
oh.
I guess the sun might have moved actually.
That happens.
Yeah. The studio lighting here.
Alright, so what do you want to see done, I think?
Yeah.
Well, you know, obviously I think, thankfully we've already had a judge order Duke to clean up all 37 of its coal ash ponds. I think Duke's probably going to appeal that decision, but really Duke needs to clean up all 37 coal ash ponds around the state of North Carolina. Removed all this toxic coal ash and move it into dry storage into lined landfills like we're required to do with all our municipal waste. And obviously Duke also needs to address groundwater contamination where people's private wells have been contaminated. They need to run free water lines. They need to do medical monitoring because we know that people have gotten sick from drinking contaminated well water. And so Duke has a big responsibility not only to clean the coal ash up out of the Dan River, but clean up all 37 of its coal ash ponds, move it to lined landfills, and then deal with the groundwater contamination of private wells. So there's a lot of work to do, a lot of problems that have been created over the last 50 years with these coal ash ponds.
Real quick, you also mentioned South Carolina.
Yeah.
Okay.
That was our next part of our story. That was great stuff.
Okay.
So tell me, I mean, this is something that you've seen in other states.
You know, yeah, I mean, the good thing is
Yeah, no, it's good.
I mean, I think on a positive note, the two river keepers in South Carolina have already got SC. All right, I'm starting.
Yeah, you're good. That's the beauty of editing. You see how many times I got it.
All right. So, on a positive note, we've had two river keepers in South Carolina have already gotten SCG&E and Santee Cooper, the two utility companies in South Carolina, to agree to clean up 11 million tons of coal ash. So that's already moving forward. So the people in North Carolina deserve the same type of clean water, public health benefits that people in South Carolina are getting there. And Duke has been delaying on that. We haven't had North Carolina Department of Environment and Natural Resources take the appropriate steps to deal with that problem. But I think now with all the media, this catastrophe, the criminal investigation, and the recent ruling from the judge that Duke is gonna have to clean up all these coal ash ponds. And then hopefully my hope is that they start dealing with some of the private wells and the contamination, the public health risk and threats that they've created from the coal ash ponds.
And you're, I mean, we're talking, this is people, you know, we've heard drinking water safe, but when it comes to these wells, this groundwater, this is drinking water. This is people who are directly intaking toxins from coal ash, correct?
Yeah, I mean, you know, Duke, and this has not been really covered in the media, but Duke has already had to run water lines down in Wilmington for wells that they contaminated from their coal ash ponds down at the Sutton plant. We know that wells are contaminated up on the French Broad River from the plants up there in Asheville. I know down at the Buck Steam plant on High Rock Lake that people have had their wells contaminated. People have heavy metals in their blood. So, you know, there is a public health risk that I don't think really has been covered very much, but that is a huge issue. And the fact that Duke has already had to run water lines, I think they're gonna have to run other water lines. That needs to be addressed as well. So we want the Dan River cleaned up. We want the coal ash ponds removed and moved to lined landfills and safe storage and dry storage, but also too the public health issues from contaminated wells, private landowners who are drinking unknowingly contaminated water. They need medical monitoring. Duke needs to address all the sources of groundwater contamination they've created, and that was part of the judge's ruling, so we'll see where that goes in the courts.
And these seepages that we've seen, you know, not just the, mm-hmm. the pipes busting, these seepages that you guys have found that we're talking about, from my understanding, the state knows about these.
Yeah, you know, the North Carolina Department of Environment and Natural Resources actually filed, legal action against Duke back in August of last year to deal with a lot of the contamination, and they acknowledge, the state acknowledged, that there's seeps leaks from the tow drains and contamination from these coal ash ponds that go into surface waters as well as continue to contaminate groundwater. So the state has known about this for a long time, and you need to look at this. These are giant farm ponds filled with toxic waste. They're unlined, and so the more waste that they put in, the more head pressure starts pushing all this stuff into groundwater and also comes out at all these different outlets into surface water. And it's become such a problem that Duke has actually had to engineer some of these stormwater devices to alleviate some of the discharge, which is illegal. And they should not be discharging illegally into the waters of the United States. They have to have a permit to do that. But this is part of the criminal investigation, and some of this information was just discovered recently. But this is the work that we've also been investigating, some of the things that we've been investigating as well.
And I guess wrapping up, if you had to just describe, you know, a lot of people may have seen the headlines, but if you just had to narrow it down to, you know, one statement, how serious of an issue is coal ash in our state right now?
Well, according to the Environmental Protection Agency, coal ash is the most biggest contributor to water pollution in the country. So in North Carolina, we have over 100 million tons of coal ash that is contaminating rivers, surface water, groundwater all over the state of North Carolina. It is a huge problem. We're talking very toxic material that, if consumed, can cause serious public health issues, if not death. So it is a huge environmental issue. It's a huge public health issue. And it's a threat to our drinking water supplies, both public surface water supplies as well as wells and private water supplies all around the state of North Carolina. And it's just really time that Duke take the appropriate steps to clean up these coal ash ponds. They've had a free ride for a long time. And I just think it's time for them to take action and responsibility and clean these things up.
Excellent. And when we're showing pictures, describe for us what you saw, just like the characteristics of the river and like what it was like texture-wise. I mean, just what you actually saw from the spill site.
Well, you know, everybody saw those horrific images of these giant plumes, these gray plumes coming out, and it's the ash that was building up in certain places. And then you go downstream, you'll still see that in some places. The water's really high today, so you probably won't see it today. But, you know, the bottom line is just these big plumes of contamination. But it's just an indication of the overall pollution that's coming from these coal ash ponds. Because even after that spill's been contained, these things are still continuing to leach contaminants into groundwater and into surface water. And they will continue to do so. They're unlined. They're basically like giant farm ponds that are filled with toxic material. And they're just going to continue to cause pollution and public health issues as long as they're there.
Great. Let me get a
Is that good?
The coal ash that's already in the river, what kind of overall impacts are we looking at from the stuff that's already been spilled?
Well, you know, obviously the state and the EPA are saying that the water is safe to drink. And again, if you're pulling water off the surface, that's probably accurate. My bigger concern is in some places, you know, for 70 miles of this river, it's contaminated with coal ash. In some places, 5 foot deep on the bottom. And what's happening over time, the longer Duke leaves it in there and doesn't clean it up, it's accumulating into the smaller macroinvertebrate life, the smaller critters, which the larger fish are going to eat. And in time, you know, 5 years out from now, when people start eating these larger fish, they're going to have these levels of contaminants in that have been absorbed through the smaller fish into the larger fish. It's called bioaccumulation or biomagnification. So the contaminants actually magnify as they go up through the food chain. And I don't think a lot of people understand that, but that to me is a greater public health risk. And if these communities are not dealing with trying to make sure that there's long-term monitoring, make sure that we're doing fish testing, make sure that there's signs to be posted when fish consumption advisories are necessary, I think it's gonna be a huge problem down the road. And then there's also the issue, this black eye on this community that this coal ash spill has created. I mean, this community really is dependent on tourism and recreation. And the Dan River has built a nice little niche economy around people coming up tubing and canoeing and kayaking and coming up here and swimming in the summer. And just because, you know, this coal ash spill happened here and there's still places upstream people can safely swim and recreate, most people don't know that. They're just going to think of the Dan River as a, you know, toxic waste site, and they're not going to come here this summer. And I think that's when you're going to start seeing a lot of the real impacts of this spill is this summer, next summer, and then when you start seeing fish that have high metals of, you know, boron and arsenic and manganese and these metals that we're finding in these coal ash spills, that's when the impact is really going to start being felt. I mean, thankfully, people can safely drink the water according to the state and the EPA, but I think the longer-term impacts is if Duke does not get this coal ash out of this river soon, this is going to start moving up through the food chain, through the fish, into people, and causing some public health issues as well. Basically, we're going to have to scoot across the river to get over there and show you that.
Okay.
And then down is the first 48 pipe where the breach happened, right down. And then the second pipe that was discovered, the 36-inch pipe, and that's right downstream. So you'll... I just don't know if he's going to be able to kind of work with that camera up that stream. I mean, you got to paddle up there. There's logs that go over. You got to walk through water. It's nasty work.
Okay.
So I don't think you want to do that. If you really want to do it, we'll do it. I just wanted to convey to you the testing that we're seeing in the seeps.
Right,
and
yeah.
I'll
use some of those pictures. I'll
okay.
get some of that info when I can to you. But while I'm thinking about sending to you directly.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So this is the Dan River Steam Station. It's been retired for a couple of years, but you can see they built it literally right on the river so they can use this water to generate the electricity. And right on the other side of this dam are those coal ash ponds. Three, two, one. So this is the Dan River Steam Station. It's been retired for a couple of years, but you can see they literally built it right on the river so they can use that water to generate the electricity. And right on the other side of this dam are those coal ash ponds.
Yeah.
dead sideways, you know. Just kind of make your way across the river if you need to go up like that.
We're gonna do our thing at number two.
Yeah, yeah, I just didn't know if I'm in the way or... No, you good? You're good, right? Where are you at?
So the second one?
Yeah.
About 150 yards downstream.
Okay.
And the current is fantastic.
Okay.
So you just kind of keep going slow and stay close to the current.
Alright.
Would it help to stable it?
Yeah, I think I got it.
Okay.
Yeah.
they've been repairing it and stuff, you know, like where it's bulging.
Yeah.
So this thing has just had ongoing maintenance issues. Like you said, you read the inspection.
Uh-huh. And then on the day, it seems like you said, I don't remember.
That's both of them.
Oh, okay.
Sorry. Again, those are relatively small compared to the other ones. Man, we're moving.
Yeah.
Now, one thing you may want to consider is
I don't know, two, three. Let me back up a little bit.
You might be able to scoot right up behind that giant.
3, 2, 1. So this is it, the 48-inch pipe that collapsed and spilled 35 million gallons of coal ash right into the Dan River. And you can see now it has been completely bricked up. Come over. Put the camera.
Okay.
That's enough of me.
Okay.
3, 2, 1. All right, so this is it, the 48-inch pipe that collapsed, spewing 35 million gallons of coal ash right into the Dan River. You can see now it has been bricked up to prevent any more leaks. 3, 2, 1. Now this is the 48-inch pipe that collapsed. 3, 2, 1. Now this is the 48-inch pipe that collapsed, and if I would have asked you about 2 months ago, many of you probably wouldn't know what coal ash is, but because of this spill, it's become a huge concern, not only for the environment, but for health reasons.
Great.
Okay. I don't know, I may do a couple of things. Ready?
Yeah, let me get a shot. Hang on.
Two, one. Now this is the 48-inch pipe that collapsed, spewing 30.
Mike still.
3, 2, 1. So this is it, the 48-inch pipe that put up. 3, 2, 1. 3, 2, 1. So this is it, the 48-inch pipe that collapsed, spewing 35 million gallons of coal ash right into the Dan River. And you can see it's all been bricked up, and it runs directly underneath these coal ash ponds. Now, we pulled several inspection reports dating all the way back to 2006 that tells Duke Energy to keep an eye on these very pipes.
Okay.
One of several pipes that we found in inspection reports dating back to 2006 that Duke was supposed to keep an eye on. That Duke was warned to keep an eye on.
Okay.
3, 2, 1. Now this is the 48-inch pipe that collapsed, spewing 35 million gallons of coal ash right here into the Dan River. You can see now it's all been bricked up. It runs directly underneath the coal ash pond. And this is one of the pipes that we found several inspection reports dating all the way back to 2006, where Duke Energy was told to keep an eye out for any unpermitted discharges.
Okay.
Check regularly. Okay, keep an eye on. 3, 2, 1. Now this is the 48-inch pipe that spewed 35 million. One more time. 3, 2, 1. Now this is the 48-inch pipe that spewed 35 million gallons of coal ash directly into the Dan River. You can see it's all been bricked up now, but it runs directly underneath the coal ash pond. And this is one of several pipes that we saw inspection records dating all the way back to 2006. 2, 1. Now this is it, the 48-inch pipe that collapsed, spewing 35 million gallons of coal ash directly into the Dan River. You can see it's all been bricked up now, but it runs directly underneath Duke Energy's coal ash pond, and it's one of several pipes that we pulled inspection reports on and found dating back all the way to 2006. Inspectors warned Duke Energy to keep an eye on.
we're going to get away with it probably, but, and that's what's crazy about people's wells, is they're telling people like their wells are safe enough to drink, but when you start mixing all these metals and you're ingesting them slowly over long periods of time, like this guy that I'm dealing with,
that's my Facebook picture now. Yeah, I don't want to get up here too early. I want to warm up. Hey, you see that?
Yeah.
All five of those lakes are heavily contaminated with PCBs.
Just our takeout coming up?
Yep.
Okay, good.
What am I, stormwater pond, or it could go. I don't know.
All right, yeah. And this is the third one?
No, there's only, as far as I know, at Lee, there's only one out discharge.
I mean, but which pipe is this? Just so I have.
The first. There's only one.
And this is the one that's in the right closest to the dam.
This is, as you're floating down, it's the far end of the dam. This is, I'm not talking about this. I'm talking about the Goldsboro Coal Ash Pond.
Okay.
Yeah, I have nothing to do with this.
Oh, I'm sorry. So I'm switching Goldsboro. This is the one
Goldsboro.
That's even bigger pond-wise. Yes. Than.
Yes, much larger, right on the noose.
Right.
The big thing that I want to drive home through this, through your larger, is it's not just a Dan River problem.
Yeah, it's everything.
So at the Lee facility, it's roughly three times as large.
Okay,
it's less.
Save that for this.
Okay.
This is good. No, I
yeah,
get
yeah,
what
yeah.
You're saying now.
Okay.
Do me a favor. Scoot over this way just a touch.
Oh.
There we go.
You have this thumb going this way.
Yeah. Right there. Perfect.
Yep.
Right.
You want sunglasses on and off?
Off if you don't mind.
And you can just talk with me, pretend he's not.
Okay.
There. So if you could first say and spell your first and last name.
Yes.
On record.
Matthew Starr. I'm the Upper Noose River Keeper. It's MATTHEW. Star, STARR.
Gotcha. All right, so coal ash is something you've been looking at for a while. Tell me just how you got started into this.
Yeah, so being the Upper Neuse River Keeper, I have one coal ash facility along the Neuse River, which is the Lee Coal Ash Facility. There's two dry ponds and one wet pond. Started looking at this a couple months before the spill happened, and what I'm hoping is that it's unfortunate that the spill happened, but hopefully it serves as a wake-up call that this isn't just a Dan River issue. This is a statewide issue. You know, there's nearly 40 coal ash ponds across the state, and the one in Goldsboro is right on the Neuse River. It's literally you could throw a rock from the Neuse River and land it on top of the coal ash dam. So it's very close, and it's much larger than the coal ash facility here on the Dan River. And a big thing with the Lee facility and why this is a statewide issue is that there's documented proven groundwater contamination, and we're talking arsenic, 60 times the state standard. I mean, these ponds are just in unlined pits, and so it's not just a call to clean up the Dan River, it's a call to clean up all the coal ash ponds throughout the state.
And this is something, I mean, not just the seepage, but there's also the talk of, are the dams safe themselves? If those were to break.
Correct.
It's just the position, right, that just makes them so.
Correct. I mean, it's so close to the Neuse River, and it's less than 10 miles upstream from Goldsboro's water intake. I mean, think about where Goldsboro is located. Think about the hurricane history that North Carolina has had. And there's other dams across a state that there's documented, that the EPA has looked at and documented, that show that the dams are not in great shape.
Yeah. What's the most frustrating part seeing all this? Seeing that, you know, there have been studies done and you guys, you know, have been out there testing.
Yeah, the most frustrating thing is that it took a spill, it took a disaster to bring this to the forefront of trying to get the North Carolina Department of Environmental and Natural Resources and Duke to clean up this contamination. I mean, that's the really frustrating part, is we've known about this. They've known about this. The state has known about this. And yet it took a disaster for it to actually be talked about.
So what's your message to Duke first?
Clean it up. Not just Dan River. Clean up all of the coal ash ponds. Remove them from surface water. Put them in lined landfills. Every single pond needs to be removed from surface water and put to a lined landfill.
And what's at stake here?
What's at stake is the environment, tourism, using our water resources as a way for people to reconnect with nature, drinking water, public safety. I mean, there's a lot at stake. It's not just an environmental problem.
Perfect. Well, anything else you want to add that you think, you know, that you guys have discovered or you're keeping your eye out on and that the public should know about?
No, I'm trying not to politicize it because it just needs to clean up. But,
yeah.
Well, let's see. All right, so Governor Croy stated that all the cleanup coal ash ponds need to be removed from surface waters, again, all coal ash ponds, and put into lined landfills. And he needs to stick with that statement. It's not something that needs another 7 years of study. You know, we know what the problem is. We know how to fix the problem, so let's do it.
Gotcha. Is it frustrating too that it took environmental groups, river keepers coming together to make, you know, this even just this first action happen?
Yeah, I mean, that's frustrating. That's kind of on the statewide level. It's not just with coal ash. It's with sediment pollution. It's with large meat production facilities. It's not just coal ash that river keeper groups are working very hard to get cleaned up. And it does get frustrating, but, you know, it's a good cause. I mean, protecting our water quality is something that must be done. And if the state's not going to do it, then there's going to be river keeper groups that advocate for these things to happen.
Perfect. And the last thing is, when you were out here and you saw right after the spill, to just kind of describe what
I wasn't out here.
Oh, not at all?
Nope.
Okay. No, that's fine then. Yep, we're good. Perfect.